When Mercyhurst College opened its doors in 1926, there was no chapel and no tower. During its first 7 years, a temporary chapel served the spiritual needs of the college. It was housed in the large room now occupied by student accounts and other business offices. It wasn't long before this makeshift chapel became so crowded that students and faculty were forced to kneel during Mass in the outer hallway. Already heavily in debt, the sisters decided they had to find the money to build a real chapel. And after several years of prayer, a benefactor was found. He was James O'Neill, who had found gold in the oil fields in the Titusville area. He was the brother of Sister Xavier O'Neill and Sister Regis O'Neill, both of whom played important roles in the early years of the college. Before his death in 1931, James O'Neill placed a large gift in his will, and the sisters had an answer to their prayers. Plans were drawn up for the construction of a beautiful chapel with an adjacent tower. The tower would have a large foyer on the ground floor and much-needed space on three more floors above. It's interesting to note that the original architect's drawings showed a much higher tower. Later, it was decided to eliminate about two-thirds of the tower, which gave it a very different look. Instead of tall and majestic, it became short, solid, and massive. In 1932, ground was broken by Mother Xavier O'Neill. A month later, the cornerstone was laid, with a Latin inscription which translated means, "In you, O Lord, I have hoped." 1 year later, the chapel and tower were completed. Two large doors at the bottom of the tower were designed to serve as the main entrance to the chapel. Above the doors, we see the Mercyhurst coat of arms. It was only fitting and proper that another coat of arms be placed on the sides, that of the Irish O'Neill family name. Through the main doors, we enter a small entranceway, which opens into a large formal foyer. On one side of the entranceway is a plaque of James O'Neill. On the other side, a portrait of his wife, Mrs. Orva O'Neill, shown with her honorary degree given to her by the college in 1939. The large foyer was decorated with many beautiful pieces of antique furniture and works of art. Its original purpose was to serve as a setting for many formal activities. It was in this room where the annual lighting of the Christmas tree took place. Many prominent visitors have been received here, including Eleanor Roosevelt and the famous Trapp family from the motion picture The Sound of Music. It was here that every student was formally presented to Bishop John Mark Gannon on what was known as Bishop's Day. One of those students was a member of the very first graduating class of 1929. Her name, Sister Eustace Taylor. After receiving her degree in English, she attended Catholic University of America, where she earned her doctorate in English and Latin. She moved to Mercyhurst as a member of the faculty in 1937. In the years to follow, she served as chairman of the English department, and for 34 years, she was a member of the Board of Trustees. Sister Eustace became the fifth president of Mercyhurst College in 1954 and served until 1960. In 1982, she was named the Distinguished Alumna of the Year. Sister Eustace will soon complete 60 years of service to Mercyhurst College, an accomplishment unequaled by any other person who has ever been associated with Mercyhurst. Here now is Sister Eustace to give you her own personal tour of the chapel.
Hello, my name is Sister Eustace Taylor, and I am very pleased to take you on a tour of Christ the King Chapel in order to show you the beautiful works of art that express both the religious and educational mission of Mercyhurst College. Let us then begin the tour. Let us begin our tour by examining the beautiful mural which wraps around the five walls behind the altar. It was designed by a Swedish artist, Stock Lhasa, and painted by artists of the Rambusch Company of Philadelphia and New York City. The mural was not part of the original design. It was added several years later. Two themes merge in the mural: the kingship of Christ and the mission of the Sisters of Mercy. The central figure, placed in a beautiful mosaic, is Christ the King in his royal robes. The mosaic, too, was not part of the original decoration. It was added a few years after the mural was painted on the walls. When the chapel was completed, there were 7 stained glass windows. When the mosaic was put in its place, it covered the center window. The 2 windows on either side of the mosaic show Christ the King and Mary as Queen, each with 3 symbols of authority: Christ with his crown holding a scepter and a globe, and Mary with her crown also holding a scepter and a globe. The remaining 4 stained glass windows are paired on both sides. On the right, a sheaf of wheat calls attention to the Eucharist, while the anchor represents hope and steadfastness. On the left side, a lamp in flame symbolizes wisdom and piety, while the cluster of grapes once again represents the Eucharist. It's important to notice the special significance of the blue and red outline in each of the 4 paired windows. Each of the 12 red squares, or jewels, represent the blood Jesus shed, the passion of his sacrifice for all mankind. The 3 figures under the mosaic represent the ministries of the Sisters of Mercy. The sister in black holding the book, the teaching ministry. The sister in white, the healthcare ministry. The young girl at the center symbolizes youth. The figures standing above the sisters on either side are Pope Gregory XVI, who signed the decree of approval when the Sisters of Mercy became a religious congregation, July 5th, 1841. The other is Archbishop John Mark Gannon, Bishop of Erie, who invited the sisters to relocate to Erie and welcomed the building of Mercyhurst in 1926 as a college and seminary for women. The Pope holds a book, the Constitutions of the Sisters of Mercy, to which he had given approval in 1841. Placed on the book is a replica of the first convent of Mercy in Dublin, Ireland, established by the foundress, Mother Catherine Macaulay, now Venerable Catherine Macaulay. The Christ the King theme is carried out in 2 scenes on either side of the mosaic. The 3 kings from the east offer gifts to the infant king. Note the king who removes his crown before offering his gift, in deference to the King of Kings. On the other side, Christ on trial stands before Pilate at the moment Pilate asks, "Art thou a king then?" The 2 figures below Jesus represent his accusers. On the far left wall, a sister is ministering to a soldier on a battlefield, which commemorates the services of the Sisters of Mercy in the Crimean War and in the American Civil War. 2 Sisters of Mercy, Mother Nolasco Kratzer and Sister Celestine Rafferty, served as nurses in Stanton Hospital, Washington, D.C., during the Civil War. On the opposite wall, the sister comforting a young woman represents the sister's ministry of guidance, counseling, and sheltering. Now, look above and behind the sister, and you will see the original design of the O'Neill Memorial with its higher peaked tower. High above the mural, a frieze circles the sanctuary as a grapevine and ears of grain to symbolize the bread and wine used in the Eucharist. Angels are an interesting detail of the mural. Two with spread wings hover to the left and right of the mosaic. A third shows Gabriel with his trumpet. A fourth angel on the opposite wall looks toward the mosaic of Christ in adoration. The reredos, which is a decorative screen behind the altar, is a rare wood carving featuring angels whose faces and hands are turned toward the tabernacle. We move now to the sanctuary lamp, which was designed by Father William Sullivan, the first chaplain of Mercyhurst. It was fashioned by the Altuff Iron Works of Erie. At that time, most sanctuary lamps hung from the ceiling. This one is very unusual. Not only is the lamp placed on a stand, it also recalls Christ's betrayal, his trial before Pilate, and his beating by a Roman soldier before his death on the cross. Here are the crown of thorns, a reed used by Roman soldiers to strike Christ on the head, and the 30 pieces of silver Judas was paid to betray Christ. The light ever burning before the tabernacle recalls Christ's words, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Life and light are frequently used as liturgical metaphors for Christ. On the altar of limestone, a medallion shows a chalice with a host above. Symbols of the Eucharist. Rays on either side symbolize light, a metaphor for grace. Both the tabernacle and the candlesticks of brass are ornamented with semi-precious stones called lapis lazuli. Not often seen today, but in medieval times the cross was jeweled to indicate victory. Large hand-carved wooden statues adorn both sides of the sanctuary. Here on the left side stands Mary in an attitude of prayer. On the right stands Joseph. The two statues were crafted by the world-famous artisans of Oberammergau, a small Alpine village in Germany renowned for their wood carving skills for over 300 years. Oberammergau is also known throughout the world for its Passion Play, which is performed every 10 years. Now let us move to the stained glass windows that decorate the walls. They represent significant moments in the life of the Holy Family and some particular Catholic beliefs. In this window, we see the angel Gabriel announcing the birth of Jesus to Mary. Rose and lily, symbols of Mary, represent both purity and martyrdom. This is the familiar nativity scene with Joseph, Mary, and a shepherd lad, centered about the infant Savior. The letters IHS are the first of the Greek name for Jesus. The sun refers to a picture of Mary where she is described as a woman clothed with the sun, with a moon under her feet, and a crown of 12 stars about her head. Notice the letters of her name, M-A-R-Y. In the next window, we see the flight into Egypt. Here, Joseph, instructed in a dream, takes the child and his mother into Egypt to escape Herod's massacre of the innocents. Imagine the anxiety of a journey into a strange land, leaving behind the comfort of the house in Nazareth and all that had been prepared there for the birth of Mary's child. Notice the two emblems here, the thistle, representing sorrow and sin, foretells the passion, the eye, the ever presence of the Father and the Trinity. In this window, Joseph and Mary find the Christ child in the temple. The occasion is the yearly visit to Jerusalem. When they prepared to return home, the child was not in their group. After searching, they found him on the third day in the temple, conversing with the teachers there, and they were astonished at his questions and answers. Mary's gesture indicates relief at finding him. The owl on the basket of scrolls symbolizes the wisdom of the scriptures. Flames indicate both fervor and martyrdom. As we go to the other side of the chapel, we recognize the celebration of the resurrection of Christ and of the life after death. In this window, where Jesus raises to life the daughter of Jairus, her family is gathered at the moment the miracle occurs. In bringing back to life this young woman, we can see a foreshadowing of his own resurrection. The drapes overhead are green, likely for hope. The lamp, which appears in the next window, may symbolize faith in Christ's victory over death. Here we find two symbols of time, an hourglass and a phoenix, a legendary bird, which after many years of life burns to ashes, from which it rises to new life. The banner and cross proclaim the resurrection, a victory over death. The butterfly and pomegranate are Christian liturgical symbols for the resurrection. In the butterfly, we see the third stage of life, beauty emerging from a cocoon. In the many seeds of the pomegranate, we see immortality. The next window shows Jesus with two of his disciples, to whom he had appeared as they came to Emmaus on the evening of the resurrection. The scene celebrates the Eucharist. He offers them bread and wine, which he had blessed, just as he had done at the Last Supper. St. Luke would later describe the event with these words, "Their eyes were opened, and they knew him in the breaking of the bread." This last window commemorates the coronation of Mary by her son. The crown overhead identifies God the Father. The dove identifies the Holy Spirit, who hovers over Mary. The son holds the crown with which he will honor his mother. Musical instruments, trumpets, a harp, and a timbrel, suggest a heavenly choir. The instruments recall a passage in Psalm 150.
Praise God in his holy place. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise him with timbrel and dance. Praise him with strings and pipes. Oh, praise him with resounding cymbals. Praise him with clashing of cymbals. Let everything that lives and breathes give praise to the Lord.
Now let us view the stations of the cross that follow the way Christ walked as he carried his cross to Calvary. They are the work of an artist from Havana, Cuba, whose name, unfortunately, we do not know. At the base of each station, there is a small square which appears to be her signature. The row of Roman numerals below indicate the date, 1948. The artist's technique for creating the stations was very unusual. She began by painting a picture. Then, in a very meticulous manner, she covered it with small pieces of clear glass to give it this mosaic effect. Each of the 14 stations tells, in striking color, the details of the last stage of Christ's passion. Let's now look at the first and the last stations. In the first, Jesus, standing before Pontius Pilate, is condemned to death. In the last station, Jesus is laid in the tomb. When the main chapel was under construction, Mrs. O'Neill asked that a small chapel be added to serve as a burial place for four members of the O'Neill family. Since it was not in the original plan, the small chapel was simply added to the side of the main chapel here. It was given the name the Queen's Chapel. The window here by the entrance to the Queen's Chapel features a crown calling attention to the kingship of Christ and the queenship of his mother. The inscription was one of Mother Xavier O'Neill's favorite expressions, bonum est confidere in domino, which translated means, it is good to trust in the Lord. This picture of the Madonna was especially well liked by Mother Xavier. In fact, she was so fond of it that she had it reproduced in exact detail on the beautiful stained glass window which dominates the far end of the Queen's Chapel. Let's now notice the exquisite beauty and craftsmanship of this window. These four vaults, two on either side, were built for members of the O'Neill family. They have not been used and are empty to this day. Let's examine now the altar area. The altar, platform, and steps are made of Italian marble, while the crucifix and candlesticks are made of amber. Note the sconces that decorate both walls on either side of the altar. Their design is unique and will never be seen again. Once the sconces were formed, the mold was destroyed, never to be used again. The angel windows are especially beautiful, alternating in vivid contrasting colors of red and green. Note how the seats are built into the walls on both sides. This design was very typical of medieval churches in Europe several hundred years ago. The kneelers are an interesting feature of the Queen's Chapel. They were designed to bring those attending a mass very close to the altar. Everything in the chapel was carefully thought out and designed to give honor to Christ the King. Even the smallest details have special significance. Note the diamond pattern on the floor, how it is repeated in the side window and in the windows on the rear foyer doors. This pattern of diamonds creates not only a sense of unity in the chapel, but gives us a powerful symbol of the precious jewel that Christ is to all of us. I hope you've enjoyed this tour. And now I would like to invite you to find time to visit Mercyhurst and to walk about in these chapels so as to experience both the artistic and spiritual presence that dwells in them.